Hi everyone, so today we'll continue with selections and mathematical functions. Again, feel free at any moment to stop me if you want to ask any questions, either by unmuting yourself or posting the question in the chat. So last time we talked about if statements. If you remember, we basically covered if statements, comparisons between integers, and we had if-else statements. And basically, we did a few examples about if statements. However, how do you write complex conditions? Since it's almost April, we basically have to fill our taxes. And the federal income tax system works based on the status and the taxable income. So you need basically multiple conditions. You need a conjunction between if the status is single or married, filing jointly, or house of health, or head of household, and you basically want to specify that you have a certain number of dependents and that your income is within some interval. It's between 11,951 and 45,500, or it's between 45,501 and 117,450, and so on. So you need, the next thing that we'll need to learn are logical conditions. And most of you, if not all, already took CSC 215, Foundations of Computer Science, which is a discrete math course, which covers logic. And you learned basically the basic logical truth tables. The negation operator, given that you have a Boolean expression, if it's true, the negation works as an inverter. True becomes false, false becomes true. The conjunction operator is the conjunction between two operands is true if and only if both operands are true. In all other cases, the conjunction is false. Disjunction is true if at least one of the two operands is true. And exclusive OR is basically the difference operator, meaning that it's true when the two true values on the left-hand side and right-hand side are different. It's either the first one is true and the second one is false, or vice versa, the first one is false and the second one is true. So we'll go over the truth tables for every single one of these operators and examples that result either in true or false for every operator. How do you type the two lines for OR? Vertical bar is above the enter key, where you have the backward slash sign. I'm gonna type it in the chat. It's basically right above the enter key. It's a vertical bar. You have to type it with shift because it's basically a secondary key to for backward slash. Okay. Let me actually set my screen to full screen. Okay, so let's see the truth tables for the different operators. First of all, the truth table for the operator negation or not. If a Boolean expression P is true, then its negation is false. And vice versa, if the Boolean expression evaluates to false, then its negation is true. So let's consider a bunch of variables. Age is 24 and gender is F. And then consider the negation of age is greater than 18. So 24 is greater than 18 is true. The negation of true is false. The negation of gender is different than F, uppercase F character. Gender was F, so F is different than F is false. The negation of false is true. So it always works as an inverter. It gives you the opposite true value to the one that you get in the inner expression. The conjunction operator. In fact, there are two conjunction operators. One is with two and signs. So basically is the one that is also called conditional operator. And we'll see why is it conditional. Because if the first operand is false, the second one is not even computed because the conjunction can only be true if both operands are true. But let's see the truth table first. So we have P1 as a logical expression, P2 also as a logical expression, and P1 and P2 with the double and sign. So this is above the 7-digit key. So again, you type it with shift 7 twice because there are basically two characters there. Anyway, if P1 is false and P2 is false, the conjunction is false. If P1 is false and P2 is true, then the conjunction is also false. If P1 is true and P2 is false, then the conjunction is also false because both of them must be true in order for the conjunction to be true. So one thing that you may actually already observe here in this truth table is that if P1 is false, in fact, there is no need to compute P2 because the conjunction of false and anything else is false. Now, this conjunction operator that we see here, the double and sign, is called conditional operator. If the first argument is false, then actually the second argument is not even computed. So it skips if the first operand is false, the second operand. And why is this important? Because sometimes your second operand might actually have side effects. Let's assume that you are writing a program and in the second operand, you would increment the value of a variable I. Because of the fact that the first operand is false of that conjunction, the second operand is not even executed. So it doesn't matter if it's true or it's false, the side effect never happens. So this is why you have to be very careful with the conjunction operator, because it's a shortcut operator. It jumps over the second operand if it's not needed to be computed. So let's see an example again. Again, we consider the two variables, age is 24 and gender is uppercase F character. And then we have a conjunction. If age is greater than 18 and gender is equal with F. 24 greater than 18 is true. Gender equal with F is also true. Therefore, the conjunction is true. Both operands are true. In the second example, 24 greater than 18 is true, but gender different than F is false. Therefore, the entire conjunction is false. However, it executes both because basically we have the first one was true. So basically we didn't know what the second one will be. But in case that the first one is actually false, the second one won't be executed. I saw that there are questions in the chat. What does P1 and P2 stand for? Part one, part two, they are basically two logical expressions. Each part is basically part of a condition. Okay. So let me show you an example what I mean about shortcut operator. So I already started Eclipse. So if I define a variable I, let's say is equal with 0, and we have an if statement. If false and I plus plus is greater than minus 1, then system.out.println inside if, and then system.println the value of I. So this is the case that I mentioned. You have a conjunction, and in this conjunction, the first operand of the conjunction is false. The second operand, although it would have a side effect, I is post-incremented, and it actually doesn't matter if it's post-incremented or is pre-incremented, or if the entire part is false or true, it will never be executed because the first part was already false. And the conjunction can only be true if both of the conditions are true. If the first one is false already, the second one is not executed. So if we run it, it will basically print 0 for the value of I. But if we change this to true, then you will see that it does increment I. However, it still doesn't print anything inside the if statement because the condition is still false. Actually, it's true because true and true. I was thinking that I have something that is false here. But we can actually do if something that is false. Let's say that we change this if plus plus I is greater than 10. It still doesn't matter. The only point is the fact that this is still executed. So the entire condition may be false, but you have side effects. And those side effects are visible. I was incremented from 0 to 1. But this only happens if the first operand is true. If the first operand was false, like we had it before, it will just skip the execution of the second operand, the second part of that conjunction. Okay. So in this case, you see that the value of I is 0. And the reason for that is that the second part was never executed. So there is a question in the chat. Do we need always a package at the beginning of our program? And my answer to that is that if your class is in the default package, that means that yeah, is directly under sources, the sources folder on the disk, then you don't need a package because basically you haven't put this class into a package. Okay. Now, let's continue with this job.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Why? What is the purpose of using false or true in the brackets? Can't you just use plus plus I greater than 10?
Yes, I can. Greater than 0, let's say.
So what is the purpose of using the true or false?
Just as an example, I wanted to show you that the conjunction, how does the conjunction behave?
Yeah, you should...
If the first part evaluates to true, then it executes the second part too. If the first part evaluates to false, then it doesn't execute the second part.
Okay. And how come, even though you didn't place the brackets over the system.out.println of inside if, it skipped over that and went to the second statement?
So if this was true, plus plus I makes I from 1, from 0 to 1. 1 greater than 10 is false. So the if statement is if false, it doesn't execute this statement. Because that condition there, that logical condition, 1 greater than 10 is false.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Also, Professor, quick question. In the future, when we use like true or false, do we have to like set it as a Boolean, like Boolean or like a specific variable, like you did int I equals 0?
Not necessarily. So basically, if you just use it in an expression, like for instance, I'm using it in this case, I don't have to assign it to anyone. If I want to use it later, so let's say that I want to assign it to a variable B, then yes, you would basically have to define the variable and initialize it with the true value, like in this case.
All right, thank you.
Welcome. Now, there is another question in the chat. What if we have another conjunction and false? So, the conjunction operator is left associative, meaning that if you have multiple conjunctions, multiple operations with the same priority, the same preference, then it will start grouping these expressions from the left-hand side. So it's basically making a binary conjunction, true and I plus plus I greater than 10. It evaluates the truth of that conjunction. And then it computes and false with the truth of that conjunction. So if you don't use parentheses, Java basically does associativity. It groups together based on rules. And the rule in Java is that all operands except assignments are left associative. So for instance, when you have, this is exactly the same as when you have, let's say, 10 divided by 5 divided by 2. There are two ways to interpret this. One of them is that it's 10 divided by 5, and the result of that is divided by 2, which of course is 2 divided by 2 and is equal with 1. Another way to parse this expression is 10 divided by 5 divided by 2, which of course this is integer division. So it will be 10 divided by the result of 5 divided by 2. 5 divided by 2 gives you the quotient of the division, and that's equal with 5. So you have different results if the associativity would be different. But in Java, the rule is that all operations are left associative, except assignments. So all operations are left associative, meaning that if you have equal operations in one expression, you start grouping from the left-hand side. Except assignments. So what do I mean by assignments? Let's say that you have integer I is equal with 1, j is equal with 2, k is equal with 3, and then you have an assignment I equal j equal k. So how again you parse this one? The rule says that assignments are right associative, which are right associative. So the idea there, it means it's that you start grouping from the right hand side for assignments. So J will be assigned the value of K, and then the value of J will be assigned to I. So after this operation that you see here, I equal J equal K, all of them will have the value 3. So the result is that I, J, and K are all equal with 3. Okay. The same happens to conjunction. So one of you wrote if statement 1 and statement 2 and statement 3. It starts basically by grouping from the left. So something like that, it will be basically, it groups statement 1 and statement 2 and statement 3. And this can be applied to any number of operations. So if you have statement 1 and statement 2 and statement 3 and statement 4 and so on, basically they are all they are parsed from the left-hand side. So it will be statement 1 and statement 2, the result of that and statement 3, and the result of that and statement 4. When you set the first part of the if statement true, is it executes I equal 1? Is it something from the lecture notes? So I'm not exactly sure what the question is about. Okay, there is a public method. Integer I is equal with 0, true, if true, and plus plus I greater than 10. So true is true, then a plus plus I is makes I 1, greater than 10 is false. So it will print 1 because basically, you execute the second part because the first one was true. We will come back to this example when we learn the unconditional operator. So now I will show you the difference, and you can think about what does unconditional mean between these two statements. So here we have false and plus plus I greater than 10. So we know that the conjunction is false no matter what, because the first one is false. However, it will still increment I from 0 to 1. So if we run this, it will print 1. If we change the conjunction into the conditional conjunction, so the only change was to have double and sign, I is equal with 0. So because of the fact that this operator, this operand is, this operator is shortcut operator, and the first operand is false, it never even executes the second one. So the difference between two and sign and only one and sign is that the one and sign will execute both operands of the conjunction no matter what. Okay. So that's called the unconditional operator. Basically the one and sign is the unconditional operator or conjunction. But we will talk about that in a few minutes. Let's return to the next operator, which is disjunction. So disjunction is OR. So if part one and part two are false and false, false or false is false. Part one, if part one is false and part two is true, false or true is true. If part one is true and part two is false, then part one or part two is true. And they are, if they are both true, then the disjunction is true. So as you can basically see, if at least one of them is true, then the disjunction is true. The disjunction is false if and only if they are both false. Again, you can see one pattern. The fact that if part one is true, no matter what the second part is, the result of the disjunction is always true. So again, the way that this is executed, this disjunction is executed, is that if the first operand of the disjunction is true, the second one is not even executed. Okay. So let's see a bunch of examples. Again, we start with the same two variables. The age is 24 and the gender is uppercase F character. First disjunction is if the age is greater than 34, or the gender is equal with uppercase F. 24 greater than 34 is false, or the gender is equal with F is true, false or true is true, just because the second one is true. The first one was false. In the second example, if the age is greater than 34 or the gender is equal with uppercase M, is false, because 24 greater than 34 is false, and gender, which was uppercase F, is equal with M, is false. F is not equal with M. So basically, a disjunction is false if both operands of the disjunction are false. Now, again, I want to show you ahead the difference between one vertical bar and two vertical bars. So the one that we saw now was basically the disjunction with two vertical bars. The meaning of that is that is true if at least one of them is true. So if the first operand of the disjunction is true, the second one is never executed because the disjunction is already known to be true. So this will print the inside if, and the value of I is still zero. I was never incremented with one. So it prints inside if and zero. If we change this to only one vertical bar, that basically it's the unconditional disjunction, meaning that it has the same result as disjunction. However, it executes both operands, no matter what. So we know it's true already, but it will still increment I and will basically have as a result the fact that I is now incremented from 0 to 1. So that's the unconditional disjunction. Now, there are not many cases when you would have side effects, especially within a logical condition. However, you're going to program with other programmers, and if they are using such expressions, you have to be aware of what's the difference between the two different operators in Java and in other programming languages. So one of them, the double vertical bar that we actually discussed here, is the shortcut operator or conditional operator. If in a disjunction, the first part is true, the second part doesn't need to be executed because true or anything else is true. When you have a single bar, it's called the unconditional disjunction, meaning that both of them will be executed. The true value is the same with the true value for the disjunction operator. However, you may have side effects. You are completely right. The AND and OR are also used in bitwise operations. So in fact, if we have time today, I will show you at the end that you have all kinds of bitwise operations. You have the complement operator, but the ones that you mentioned there are the vertical bar that is used for bitwise OR, and one AND that is used for bitwise AND. Okay, so you are completely true. I will get into this basically today, hopefully, towards the end of the lecture.
Professor, for the unconditional operator with the OR, if they're both false, will it still execute both the statements?
Yes.
Okay.
So the results are always the same with OR and AND. However, it executes all operators, all parts of the conjunction or disjunction. The only difference is that this one AND and one OR always evaluate both operands, no matter what.
Okay, and the single operand, unconditional one, doesn't write down true or false, right?
In our case, in this example that I will show in here, this is true. So basically, both of them will print out inside if, because no matter if we have one or two of them, the condition of the if statement is always true.
Okay.
In the case of AND, we had that issue that if this is false with double AND, it basically doesn't execute the increment on I, so I is still zero. However, it never prints this inside if because the conjunction is false. We already know that because the first part is already false.
But okay, so in both, you don't print down in the console true or false? That's for the computer to know.
We are never printing the result of this if statement. So it will never print anything here in the case, like basically what's the true value. It will only print whatever we have within system out print statement.
Okay, so you have to use Booleans to print out true or false?
Yes. So if you want that, then you would do something like this. Boolean B is equal with this condition. So you basically use that condition kind of like a flag. You compute it prior to actually testing it. And you can also print it if you want. So now we have B. So you can do system.out.println the value of B. So now we will actually also see what B was, if it was false or it was true.
Okay. Okay, I see. Thank you, Professor.
Welcome. Okay. Next operator that we'll learn is called exclusive OR. So exclusive OR is like the difference between two values. So basically, it's true when the two true values, the two parts, the two operands of the exclusive OR or XOR are opposite in value. So if P1 and P2 are both false or both true, the result of exclusive OR P1 XOR P2 is false. If P1 is false and P2 is true, or P1 is true and P2 is false, they have opposite values, the result of the XOR is true. So it's really, you can consider it as being equivalent with not equal, because not equal can also be used for Booleans. So really, this is the negation of that the true values are equivalent. Okay. So again, two examples. Consider that the age is 24 and the gender is uppercase F character. Age greater than 34, exclusive OR, gender is equal with F is true, because 24 greater than 34 is false. Gender is equal with F is true. So we have false XOR true is true. In the second example, I have a typo. I actually meant XOR because this is an example for XOR. So let me change this. I will update the slides after the lecture today. Let me close it. So in the second example, we have age is greater than 34, XOR gender is equal with M. It's false because age greater than 34, 24 greater than 34 is true. And it's false, sorry about that. And gender F is equal with M is also false. So we have false, XOR, false, which is false because the two true values are of the same value, false. So basically, therefore, the XOR is false. So let's see some examples. Let's assume that we define a variable. How would XOR work with three operands? That's a good question, exactly as I told you earlier about left associativity. So XOR, as all the other operands, are left associative. So basically, if you have something that is true, XOR, let's say false, XOR, true, it will start grouping them from the left-hand side. So we have, in fact, true, XOR, false, XOR, true, true, XOR false is true because they have opposite values. XOR true again is false. So basically, when you have multiple operands, it will start grouping from the left-hand side and execute them. And it's always a binary operation because you are grouping from the left-hand side. All operators in Java are left associative, again, with the exception of assignments, because assignments have to be executed from the right-hand side to assign the previous value to the next value, to the next value, up to the first value. Okay, so what's the result of each one of these operations? Boolean result is a Boolean variable. Result is assigned 5 less than equal with 9 is true. Result is assigned not 5 less than equal with 9 is false because 5 less than equal with 9 is true and the negation of that is false. Result is assigned 3.9 greater than 3.19 is true. 3.9 is greater than 3.19 in reals. Result is equal with lowercase a is equal with uppercase a. They are different Unicodes. So lowercase a is 97, uppercase a is 65. 97 is different than 65. They are different. So result is false. Result is equal with 5 less than equal with 9 and 8 is strictly greater than 9 is false because although 5 less than equal with 9 is true, 8 greater than 9 is false and the conjunction of true and false is false. And the result is equal with 5 less than equal with 9 or 8 greater than 9. Since 5 is less than equal with 9 is true, the entire disjunction is true. The second part is not even executed. Now, a little bit more complex examples. Let's assume that one question is, if a number that is read from the command prompt is divisible by 2 and 3. So in order to check if a number is divisible by some other number, we basically execute division and we collect the remainder of the integer division with that number. So in order to check if the number is divisible by 2, we do number modulo 2 equal with 0. That means that the remainder after division with 2 is 0. That means that the number must have been divisible exactly with 2. Similarly, number modulo 3 is equal with 0 checks if the number is divisible by 3, if it's a multiple of 3 and there is no remainder after division. In the case that the question was to find if the number is divisible by 2 or by 3, we use disjunction instead of conjunction. In the case that we want to check if the number is divisible by 2 or 3, but not by both, we use XOR, exclusive OR. So either that is divisible by 2, or that is divisible by 3, but not by both, because XOR would return false if they are both true. Even a more complex condition. I don't know if you know the definition of a leap year. So most of you basically, or all of you, know that every 4 years we have a leap year. But it's not quite exact, because the time that the Earth takes to go around the sun is not a precise number of days, 364. Basically, you have 364 and a quarter of a day. So, but it's not quite exact either. So let me tell you the condition. The condition for the year to be leap year is that is divisible by 4, but not by 100, or is divisible by 400. So the idea is that is divisible by 4, meaning that every 4 years we have a correction in day, and one day is added to February. However, every 100 years, we have another correction to that rule, because basically it was not exactly a quarter of a day. And we have another correction, basically, if the year, even if it's divisible by 4, but is divisible by 100, it's basically not always leap year. And why I mean always, because if it's divisible by 400, it's a leap year. So let's see first the condition, and then I will give you a few examples. So let's assume that we read with a scanner a year as an integer, and the condition now becomes if the year modulo 4 is equal with 0 and the year modulo 100 is not equal with 0. So for instance, 2020 is divisible by 4, but not by 100. So the conjunction is true, because it's divisible by 4 and not divisible by 100. Or the year is divisible by 400. So for instance, the year 2000 didn't satisfy the first part of this disjunction, because it was divisible by 4, but also by 100. However, is divisible by 400. So basically it was a leap year. Another example, the year 1900. So 1900 is divisible by 4, is not divisible by, it's divisible by 100. So year modulo 100 different than 0 is false. So the first condition is false because it's a conjunction between the two. However, 1900 modulo 400 is not equal with 0. It's equal with 2. So basically, 1900 was not a leap year. So the first correction every 100 years for 300 years, it's a correction year that is not a leap year. But every 400 years, there is a correction to that correction to actually have a leap year. Okay. And that means that an day is added to February. February 28th.
Can you use XOR here, Professor?
Can you use XOR here? Maybe you can find an equivalent expression to this, but I don't think so.
Is it because if they're both false, then the output will be true, which is wrong in our scenario?
That's completely true. That's one reason. That's exactly the reason, because in the other case, it will work for year 1900. But you actually gave your answer that if you put here, then 2021, this year, would be declared to be a leap year, but it's not.
Okay, so even if you said the year modulus 4, and then XOR, the year is equal to 100, right, equal to 0?
Yes.
Without the not, if you took out the not, you still can't do that, right? Because you would get a true output if both of them were false.
Yes.
Is that the only reason, or is there another reason?
That's enough, no? You're getting wrong results for leap years.
Okay.
So let's actually try it. So I'm going to define an integer. Actually, we need the scanner first. So I'm gonna ask the user to enter a year. And I prefer not to put println. So in the same line, the user enters the year. We define a scanner input, a new scanner for the system in. And now we can define an integer year is input.nextInteger. And now we can actually put our condition. So our condition was that the year is divisible by 4 and not by 100 or divisible by 400. And here we are going to write that it's a leap year. And let's have an else for the other case. Else not leap year. Okay, so let's try it. So there were a few questions. Let's say 1,900, not a leap year, because although it was divisible by 4, it was not divisible by 100, and is not divisible by 400. 1,904, it was a leap year, 4 years later. Then year 2000 was a leap year because of the second condition. The first condition was actually false. Let's put 2020 was a leap year. And of course, 2021, our year is not a leap year. So now your proposal was that I'm going to change this to XOR. I'm going to change this to equal. And I'm going to completely delete the other condition.
Okay. Oh, you could have kept the other condition. I was just asking about the first.
Okay, so I'm gonna leave both conditions. Is this okay?
Yeah.
So now let's try to find counter examples. We knew what are the leap years and which are not. So 1,900 is not, that's fine. 1,901 is not leap year. Let's say 1,904, it was a leap year. So let me think if there is, so okay, so up to now, let's see, what about 2000? That's fine because of the other part. So what I would like to find is the counter example for this condition.
You need a number that's divisible by 4 and 100?
You have 1,900. But it already said 1,900, that is not leap year. And that's exactly the result that we were getting before. So really, I'm trying to find out. So we were looking at the cases where this was. So the problem is that those are covered. By the first condition, so the second condition, but not by the. So 1,900, this is true, and this is true. So why did you give us? So this was false, and still this was also false because it's not divisible by 400. So I don't actually see why did we get true, that is not leap year. Oh, because this is false and this is false.
Oh, which equals true. And then
So which is, oh no, this is false, and this is false, and this is false. So it goes on the other branch and means not leap. Somebody is proposing 2100. Let's just test it. And that was, is not leap, and is correct. So my question really is, what we changed was from conjunction and not to exclusive or and equal. And so the question here, somebody is asking, why is not leap? Because in the original condition, it basically said that years that are divisible by 4, but not by 100, are so years that are divisible by 4, like 2100, and not by 100, are not are leap year. But 2100 is divisible by 100. This condition is false. And this condition is false. So it makes sense that it's not a leap year. Okay. But still, I don't have an answer to your question. If the conjunction that we had before is equivalent with this exclusive or that we have here.
Okay.
I don't have an answer to that. So I have to think. So what happens to the true cases? We know what happens to the false cases. So let's build a truth table. I can't see it, unfortunately. So if we have a P1 and we have a P2 and we have P and P1 and P2. That's the truth table for conjunction. And now you have P1, you have P2, and you have the negation of P2 because you eliminated the not equal. And the question is, what's the truth table for P1 XOR not P2? And if we find the counterexample, it will basically be the counterexample to that example. So let's actually build the truth tables for these two and see what's the difference. So we have true. Actually, let's start with falses. False, false. And this is false. And we have, let me just copy the previous line. False, 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 true. And true, false is false, and true, true, true. So let's see in the second case. Let me just add the other formula here. So we have not P, the inverse of P, and we have P1 XOR not P2. Okay. So now this is not P2. Okay. So here we have true, false, true, oops, true, false. And here we have the XOR between this column and the first column. So true, false, it's true. False, false is false because they are the same. True, true is false. True, false is true. And it looks to me that there is a case when the two true values are different. However, what happens in that case? So that is the case where this was false and this one was true. However, we forgot the condition for the year being divisible by 400. So what happens with this case in that case? So The negation of this is exactly that the year is divisible by 100 and P1, but P1 in that case was false. So it was not divisible by 4. So not divisible by 4 and not, but in that case, the conjunction is false. However, this is true. So this may actually give us, so we are looking for a case that is not divisible by 4 and not divisible by 100, but it is, what is divisible? No, it can't be divisible by 400 in that case. So let's return by to our program. How does it behave to 1901? It's not leap. And that's because both conditions are false. So this is false. But this was true. Okay, I have to think about this. I don't get how you are getting the same. I mean, in these cases, we are getting the same true value. So we are only looking at the first case that we get different true values.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't realize my question would be so complicated. But
it's a good question.
Yeah, it's okay. We can cover in office hours or something.
Thank you. I will try to do it before that and maybe post it on Piazza.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
So the unconditional AND and OR. And I already told you that they work exactly the same with AND and OR, with the exception that these unconditional operators always evaluate both operands. So here we have an example. If X is 1, what's the value of X after each one of these expressions? So X is greater than 1 and X plus plus is less than 10. Because of the case that X is 1, 1 greater than 1 is false. The conditional operator says the entire conjunction is false. It will never execute the second part. So the value of X is still 1 after that expression. However, in the second case, although the first operand is false, because this is unconditionally, it would still execute the second one. It doesn't matter if it's true or false, it still increments X from 1 to 2. And that's the difference. Basically, when we have unconditional operator, we have an increment because of the second operand of the conjunction. Similarly, in the case of the disjunction, if X is 1, then 1 equal 1 is true. In the case of the double vertical bar, the disjunction, the conditional disjunction or shortcut disjunction, the entire disjunction is true because the first operand was true. So the second part is never executed, therefore X is still equal with 1. In the second case, unconditional disjunction, it will execute both operands. Even if it's already true, known to be true, X will be incremented with 1 to X being equal with 2. So that's the difference between unconditional and the previous conditional operators. Next type of statements that we will learn are switch statements. So one example that I find always the best to think about switch statements are those phone menus. When you call some number and an automatic robot tells you, press 0 if you want to ask a question. Press 1 to read your balance. Press 2 to speak with a customer representative and so on. That's exactly what a switch statement does. It takes the variable and it compares it with all of these options into one single comparison. The way that is done internally is that it basically applies a hash function on this variable. And based on the value, it jumps directly to one of the options. So all of these statements that you see here with breaks between them are stored in the same block of memory, somewhere away from the switch statement. The switch statement basically does a choice. If the variable is 0, it jumps here. If the variable is 1, it jumps here, and so on. So in one comparison, it has a go-to statement, a jump that directly jumps somewhere in the block of statements, of instructions that are laid within these switch statements. So it's a little bit more efficient than if statements. If this would have been done with if statements, you would have if it's equal with zero, then execute this block here. Else, if it's equal with one, then execute this block and so on. In the case of switch statements, it does a single comparison with all of these values and jumps at one of these locations. The only difference is that because it's not like an if-else statement that you have separated the branches, in switch statements, all of these are into a single block of memory. So you need an additional break statement to end that case, because in case that you don't have this break statement, it just continues with the next instructions afterwards. It doesn't break the block. So these break statements are required. You are required to have break statements within the different cases. Now, that's if you want them. If, for instance, multiple options take you to the same block, one thing that is customary is that you basically have case, one case followed by the next case immediately, and then the block of statements. So in that case, you wouldn't use a break statement because you would want to have a block that is executed for multiple cases. I will show you an example in a couple of minutes. So the flow chart for switch statement really looks like this. If the variable is zero, execute some statements, then go to the next statements after the switch statement. If the variable is one, execute some statements, then go again with the break to the next statement after the switch statement. And so on up to if it was not equal with any one of those values, you may have a default case. The default case is what statements are executed if the variable was neither of these values. So these are these statements. This default is optional. You don't actually need to have a default. It's not required. Now, the type of expressions that come in a switch statement can be of char, byte, short, int, and string. String was only added in Java 1.5. Up to then, basically you had switch statements only for these discrete types, which are quite small. An integer is 4 bytes. And then you have multiple values. The first one that is equal with the value of that expression will be the one that will start executing immediately. Okay. One thing about the cases, this must be values. This must be values within the domain of the switch expression type. They cannot be expressions themselves, like x plus y. You must have constant values there, value 1, value 2, value n, and so on. The break statement is optional, but what it does, it terminates that case. Otherwise, it will just go to the next case without actually ending. And I will show you an example. Consider this example. You have the character ch, a variable of the type char, assign the value lowercase a. And then we have a switch statement, and it switches on the character ch. So since ch is equal with a, it starts the execution of the blocks with system out println ch. But because there is no break statement, it just continues and executes the other ones. So in the end, it printed not only one A, it printed 3 A's. If the character was equal with B, then it will print 2 B's because it will start here at case B and execute this statement and this statement. If it was equal with C, it will print a single C. So maybe something that we didn't expect. So usually what we have are completely separate cases. So if the character is A, like we had before, then it starts executing the case for A, and then it breaks, meaning that we finish with that case, jump out. Okay. So switch case statements are used for efficiency reasons, more compact code, because you don't have if statements for every one of those and else's, but they do require to have this break, because if you don't have the breaks, then it just continues with the next statements. Usually they are used for menus. So maybe in many cases, you may actually have seen this kind of switch statements. Let me show you an example. Let's say that I want to implement a temperature converter, but I'd want it to work for Fahrenheit to Celsius, Celsius to Fahrenheit, Fahrenheit to Kelvin, and so on. So usually I get a bunch of options. So one corresponds to convert Fahrenheit to Celsius. And then two corresponds to convert Celsius to Fahrenheit. And so on. You basically have option one does this, option two does this, and so on. And then you are asked, enter your choice. And maybe in the parentheses you have one or two. So now we would use, usually we have println statements here. And then we would use a scanner to read the choice. So let's define this input scanner somewhere before the print statements. Now we can actually have the integer option as the next, as the option. And then you have a switch statement. So switch on the option. And now we have for case one, implement Celsius to Fahrenheit. So basically, let's say that we actually just print that we do that conversion. Okay. And then break. And then for case two, we do the other conversion from Celsius to Fahrenheit. So this is what switch state case statements are used for. Sometimes you basically have multiple keys that take to the same option. So let's say that these keys were uppercase A and uppercase B, and we ask the user to enter A or B, but, and we read the character car option. There is no next car, so let's actually read the next line and character at index zero will give us the first character. But now we want this to work for lowercase and uppercase letters. So usually you have case if it's lower or if it's upper, you have the same code. So you see, basically we take advantage of the fact that there is no break statement here, and either that A is in lowercase or uppercase, it boils down to actually this line of code being executed. And similarly, we could have for lowercase B or uppercase B, basically execute a different conversion. Of course, another way to do this, which we'll learn today in mathematical functions and character functions, is that I can have done character dot to uppercase of that character option. So that's a static function in the character class, and whatever the character is, it converted it to uppercase. So that's a different way to write the case statement. Okay, so there are a bunch of questions. Can we use the same variable for two cases? I assume that this is, I just responded to that here. Maybe, I'm not exactly sure that if you refer by cases to letter case or something else. Okay, next, conditional operator. So sometimes, based on a condition, we want to assign to a variable different values. So consider the following if statement. If x is greater than 0, y is assigned 1, else y is assigned minus 1. This is equivalent with a single expression, which uses what is called the conditional operator. It's a Boolean expression followed by question mark, followed by one expression, followed by colon, followed by a different expression. The meaning of that is that if the Boolean expression is true, then the value of this entire conditional expression is expression one. If the Boolean expression is false, then the value of the expression is expression two. So here we have an equivalent statement to that if statement that we had above. Y is assigned the conditional statement, if x is greater than 0, then 1, else minus 1. So basically, you write one expression that is conditional on the value of the first value of the first Boolean expression. It chooses one of the two, the true case or the false case. It can be used in arithmetical expressions like this one or string concatenations. Like, for instance, you want to print if a number is even or odd. It's easy to do. You basically check if the number modulo 2 is equal with 0, then you print the concatenation of number plus is even. Else, you print the concatenation between number and is odd. Another way to write this is actually number concatenated with, and then you put in within parentheses this stuff. If the number is modulo 2 is equal with 0, then is even, else is odd. So it's really an expression, but it's conditional. Which value will be returned is based on the Boolean condition that precedes it. And all that you need is kind of like an operator that has three arguments. The Boolean expression that comes before question mark, then one operand that will be returned if the Boolean expression was true, which appears between the question mark and the colon, and then one that is used when the Boolean expression was false, that it appears after the colon. That's what is called the conditional operator. Now, operators in Java have a precedence, and this is in order of priority. The highest priority operators are post-increment and post-decrement. Then we have unary plus and minus. You can put plus in front of a number. It just basically makes the assertion that that's a positive number. It's not required sign. But you can also put minus in front of an expression saying that this is minus the value of that expression. Those are the unary plus and minus. Then with the same priority, we have pre-increment and pre-decrement. Typecasting has higher priority than the Boolean not and bitwise not. Multiplication, division, and modulo remainder operator have higher priority than plus and minus, which have higher priorities than comparisons because you want the operands of the comparisons to be executed, and then you want the comparison executed, which have higher priority than equality, than equal and not equal, which have higher priority than exclusive or. Conjunction has higher priority than disjunction, which has higher priority than assignments. All operators, as I said earlier, are left associative with the exception of assignments. So this helps us when we are given a expression to decide what's the order of operations. And always, like in the acronym PEMDAS, you execute parentheses first. Like in this case, 3 plus 4 is it's executed and it's 7. Then you execute multiplication in the order that multiplications appear. So 4 by 4 is 16. Then 5 by 7 is 35. Then addition, again, addition and subtraction have the same priority, but we start from the left-hand side. It's left associative, 3 plus 16 is 19, 35 minus 1 is 34, and finally the comparison, 19 greater than 34 is false. So always execute based on the operator precedence and associativity rules. Now, assignment is right associative. If you have an expression like this one, A is assigned B plus equals C equal 5. Basically means that C is assigned 5, then B is incremented with the value of C, which is 5, and then A is assigned the new value of B. So it's right associative. That's the only operators, all the assignment operators are right associative. If statements can be used in a lot of statements, like the ones in the lab that you basically have to, based on an input from the user, compute a value, a score, for instance. Similarly, we can use them in our changemaker program that we've wrote in the previous labs. So if the original amount was not less than one and it's not greater, it's not, it's, if it's less than one or greater than 99, we print out that it's out of range, and only on the else clause, we compute the number of quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. Similarly, you can actually print out only if the number of quarters is different than zero, then you would print the quarters. In fact, you can even distribute the, if you want, the plural quarters or quarter. So a nested if would be that if the quarters is different than zero, then you print number of quarters plus quarter, string quarter. And then if the number of quarters is one, you print a new line. If the number of quarters is not one on the else case, you print the S. So you make it plural. So if statements are very useful. Any questions before we go to mathematical functions?
Yes.